But what I'm really interested in as well is there's that anticipation of a sexual encounter. Maybe you get like sexy text messages or Snapchats. I'm really keen for like the pudding to like Snapchat you through the day while it's being made, being like, you know, like with the formality of dining. I really love high quality food. I really love like molecular gastronomy and fine dining. But I'm also consciously aware that it makes people feel quite uncomfortable going to a restaurant such as that. So I'm really interested in having dining experiences where you have a very formal environment that you can then wreck. So like gourmet food fights, for instance, where you have little trebuchets and catapults and stuff, and you're served like Michelin starred food, but you've got to throw it at your friend for them to be able to eat it, or like, you know, and actually deformalize that and inject that playful element that I've got from writing street games over the last 3 years. And actually bring that to dining. That's really what's kind of exciting and driving me at the moment.
How do you come here?
I met George last year when we were running the zombie game in Stratford. So I write and direct 2.8 Hours Later, which is the world's largest street game. It's a cross-city zombie chase game. I'm actually moving on from that to pursue dining now, and I'm kind of here in both scopes. So I'm representing Slingshot today, but I'm also representing Understory, which is the dining thing. And it's been really interesting at the conference to see all walks of life talk about their approaches to art. There does seem to be a general consensus, like a concern about what it means to be an artist in this day and age, and whether or not is actually a helpful term to call yourself an artist, whether that inhibits or actually helps you progress. But I really like the pragmatism of the people that have been asked to talk as well, you know, like Verity and the Johns, both Johns have come up with some really interesting. I was interested by his point about how he thinks that there's a lot more cultural contributors, and as a result he feels it's kind of hitting a point of saturation perhaps in audience attendance. I don't think that's the case though. I think we're developing as a nation, and more people are getting an opportunity to experience culture in forms that perhaps they wouldn't have beforehand. And coming back to the zombie theme, what can zombies teach the art, which is I guess the focus of the panel I was on. The whole zombie genre is full of everything from video games to really amazing novels, like World War Z is a geopolitical masterpiece, which, and as an audiobook, is arguably more enjoyable. The film is terrible. But The Last of Us is one of the best video games ever made, and that spawned comic book and seemed to be film. And it's as a genre, has created hugely influential works of art for a whole load of different disciplines across loads of different media. But quite happily will bounce from one to the other. The Walking Dead is a video game, is a comic book series, it's a film. And I think the arts at large needs to kind of embrace that flexibility and being able to tell stories set maybe within the same universe or stories or themes and allow people to interact with them in their preferred medium, which is perhaps very expensive. Yeah, so for 2.8, you come and play. We have like hundreds of players a night who play in teams of 8. You can volunteer to be a zombie as well.
Okay.
But we also have like tiered aspects about being an artist within it. So for example, what I mean by that wasn't a very eloquent way of saying that. We have actors, you can audition, you can become an actor. But we also have extras, which is kind of an intermediary. And that doesn't necessarily mean you need to have performance experience beforehand, because such are the demands of the event. They're so unique to the event that really you don't need performance, because the performance training you might have is kind of obsolete by our requirements. So that's like an intermediary opportunity for people to get involved. And then we have our volunteers, and then we have our players. At the end of the day, they're all thrown into the same party at the end as well, which is really lovely. So we have such a wide demographic of people taking part. It's really surprising how you'll meet one person in a city who's come to play it, and then 2 cities later, they'll be a zombie, and then 3 cities later, they'll be applying to be a stage manager, or they'll be applying to be a thing. The event kind of finds its patrons and also its staff. It is expensive. If you were to compare it to like, I don't know, going out on a night out, maybe you would feel a bit loath to part with £40 to go to a club night. But it's not a club night. And there are like theatre tickets in London that go for hundreds, but Book of Mormon is hundreds and hundreds of pounds. This is a multi-locational cross-city game. It's the largest in the world. It's a huge immersive storyline. You have agency. You know, you can you have consequences to the actions that you have during the game. So if you mess up, your friend will get eaten. You know, if you don't solve the puzzle, you fail your mission. There's an opportunity to explore heroism that you just don't get from anything else. And it being set in the real world and not being digital as well, I think provides a fantastic opportunity to actually, it's not really immersion because it's living it. For all extents and purposes, if you're being chased by a zombie that's going to tag you, or you're being chased by one that bites you, being chased by one full stop is real. And it's a real experience and it's palatable. And that's why I think people are quite happy to part money with it, because it's worth it. I mean, moving into dining, like Heston Blumenthal's restaurant, The Fat Duck, is £250 per person, plus wine, plus tip, which is like 10-15%. And that's like a holiday for two people. If you were to go there, that's like £700. But you're not going to eat that ever anywhere else, have that experience anywhere else. So I think it's justifiable if it's the quality's good enough. No, Sling Show is a fully commercial enterprise. I think in the beginning when they first did the Street Games Festival, IGFest, they had some sort of subsidy, but no, the game's been running as a commercial venture for 3 years now, which again is part of the reason what makes it such a unique company. Understory is hopefully receiving some funding. Touch wood. Yeah, we've got some funding to work with the University of West of England, but I'm hoping for some Arts Council support as well. But then thereafter, you know, it'll be someone else's turn to get R&D money, and it'll be someone else's turn to come up with some mad idea. So hopefully by then it'll be a commercial enterprise, because I think that's really where the heart of the arts industry needs to go, is actually be more commercially orientated. There are more opportunities now to talk to your audience. Social media has allowed us to have conversations that would have been impossible otherwise, and as a result, there is much more harmony between what you want to create as an artist and what people want to consume. So being commercially orientated isn't such a frightening or sellout position as it used to be considered. It's actually quite admirable, I would say. I genuinely had very little forewarning as to what this company was. I had George like mentioned something about a giant foot, and we turned around the corner and sure enough there's a giant foot, so that was interesting. There's a lot of people here who have forged their own path. So everything from the guy who runs the Bureau of Silly Ideas to Verity McIntosh from the PM Studio, these are all people who have really not sacrificed what they wanted to do in terms of their dreams. And that's really important when you're working in emergent forms, to like meet people who have actually risked everything to get where they are. So inspiration is probably the most palatable thing I've felt so far. It's like, wow, a guy, he's made a living out of this? That's great. Oh, brilliant. Maybe there's hope, yeah, you know, that sort of thing.
Yes.
But, you know, if you never wake up from the dream, then how is it different from life?